Okay, welcome to Operating Systems Lecture 10. Alright, so last time we were talking about locking. Right? What is a lock? A lock is a type or is just a variable. So let's say a variable of type lock, let's say struct lock. It has a state, right? Which is this is stateful, state represents whether locked or not, right? So a lock could either be locked or it could be unlocked. So that's the state in the lock, and then there are two functions, acquire. And release. Right. So the two functions acquire and release that set this acquire sets the state of locked to locked, and release sets it to unlocked. The only difference is that acquire waits for the lock to become unlocked before it sets it to locked. Right. So an acquirer can only set a lock to locked state if it found it in unlocked state, right? And we've seen an implementation of acquire and release using atomic hardware instructions. We looked at the exchange instruction last time, all right? So today I'm going to talk about how we use locks, right? So how could we use locks? So let's look at the example that we had last time where we were trying to insert. So let's say there's a list. And insert basically takes list, a pointer to a list, and a data element, which is let's say an integer, and just does the following. It says, okay, it says element is equal to new. List element, right? Let's say there's another type called list element. Then we say e dot data is equal to data, right? Let's say the list element has a field called data, right? And then we say e dot next is equal to l dot head. Okay, and then I say L dot head is equal to E, right? So that was our insert function. Notice that I made a slight different modification from the last example. I'm also passing a pointer to the list structure, and the list structure has a field called head. Head is basically the first element of the linked list, right? And so I append this element E to the list. So for example, if this is L. L will have a head pointer, and head will be pointing to the first element of the list, right? And then this could go on, right? So that's the structure. And when I append, when I call insert L data, then I have another element here, and I put data here, right? And I remove this link from here and mark it here and put it like this. So that becomes my new linked list. So that's insert. So that's what this code is doing. Except that, of course, we talked about last time that this code is wrong because these two statements should have executed atomically. So let's say this is statement A and this is statement B. Then thread 1 should have finished. If thread 1 has started executing statement A, it should also execute statement B before any other thread gets to run statement A, right? So so basically we can solve, so we need this area to be atomic. Atomic with respect to itself, right? Atomic with respect to itself. Right? How do I make it atomic? Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add calls to acquire and release, right? So I'm going to say acquire and release. Right? And inside I'm going to put a lock variable. Okay. Firstly, notice that I'm only putting acquire and release around these two statements. I'm not putting acquire and release around the entire function. Right? Why? Because only these statements need to be atomic. These statements are operating on private variables. They are not operating on shared variables. The only shared variables are l.head. L and l.head. Right? So only statements that are accessing shared variables, they need to be protected. Other statements don't need to be protected. That's number one. Number two, what should I acquire? So how should I decide which lock to acquire? Right? So far I don't have any lock. One option is that I declare a global lock, right? So let's say I have a global lock. I declare a global lock here, say struct lock glock. Right? I declare a variable called glock, that's a global lock. And what I do here is I say okay, acquire glock. Right? And release glock. Because it takes an address, let's just put an ampersand for it. Okay. So is this code correct? Well, let's see. If two threads try to enter the critical section, one of them is going to have to wait. Only one of them is going to get into the critical section, and only after it has finished exiting the critical section, the other thread can enter. Right? So it is correct. Right? What it is doing is it's making this area, this critical section, atomic with respect to itself. Two threads could not be in the critical section at the same time. Only one thread could be inside the critical section. The other thread, if it wants to get into the critical section, it must be waiting at the acquire state. Right? So we understand that. Now the question is this the best way of doing it? Well, let's see. I've taken a global lock. Right? What does this mean? Let's say I have two lists, L1 and L2, right? And one thread is inserting into L1 and another thread is inserting into L2. They're completely different lists. So if there are two lists, L1 and L2, thread 1 is inserting into L1 and thread 2 is inserting into L2, then did these statements need to be atomic with each other, with respect to each other? No, not really, right? Because one thread is operating on one thread. Another thread is operating on another list. So the two lists are completely different. So it's okay. You didn't need to ensure that the two threads don't interleave. The two codes don't interleave, right? On the other hand, because I'm using a global lock, this code will force that these state, the atomic section, this region is executed separate, is serialized even for different lists, right? So let's remember this code, and let's say there's this thread 1. It calls insert on L1, and let's say it wants to insert value 1 into L1, and there's another thread called T2 that wants to insert into L2 a value called 2. Right? These are completely unrelated. This is inserting into L1. This is inserting into L2. So there is no race condition. There is no race between these two statements. Right? But the way we have written our code, what will it do? It will serialize. So it will say that, okay, let's say thread 1 gets the lock first. So the thread 1 is going to execute first. So acquire glock. Thread 2 is going to try to acquire glock and it will have to wait. Right, so it will wait, and this one will continue, then it will release glock, and then this will acquire glock. Right, so you are serializing Right? This act of actually making sure that these two threads cannot execute concurrently is also called serialization. Right? So you're serializing the execution of these two codes, even though they didn't need to be serialized. So serializing unnecessarily. Right? So what is the problem? The problem is that you're using the same global lock irrespective of which list I'm inserting into. Right? What is the solution? Well, the solution could be that I could have had two locks, one for list 1, another for list 2. Right? So I could, list 1 could acquire G lock 1 and release G lock 1, and list, the thread 2 could acquire, will not have to wait, it will acquire G lock 2. Right? And release G lock 2. So in this case, if you have separate locks, you could allow them to execute in parallel. Yet you are making sure if there's a third thread, T3, that is also inserting, let's say, in L1, element 3, then this will get serialized. So these thread 1 and thread 3 will get serialized because they are both going to try to take G lock 1. But thread 2 will not get serialized because that will take G lock 2. Right? So how do you do this? In this case, I had a G lock, and you know, I don't know how many lists there are, how many locks I should have. So one way to do this is to say that inside the list structure itself, have another field called lock. All right? And instead of acquiring G lock, acquire L dot lock. Right? Similarly, release L dot lock. Okay? So one thread will acquire, so now you have a lock per list, and you are going to serialize operations on the same list, but operations on different lists will be able to continue in parallel. Okay. Recall that a lock is nothing but one variable, right? That variable could be a global variable. That variable could be a field in a structure. So in this case, we have made the variable to be a field in the structure that is allocated on using new. Okay. So this is the other way of doing it. Right. The previous one where we were using a global lock. So global lock, the G lock case, global, is called coarse grain locking. Lock per list is called fine grain locking. Okay. Fine grain permits better concurrency, so permits more concurrency. Right, as we saw in our last case. Okay, all right, so let's take some more examples. Let's say I have a thread that says, that has two counters, hits, let's say there are two global counters, hits and misses. Okay, and let's say there are multiple threads. Okay, and each thread could sometimes call hits plus plus, and sometimes it can call misses plus plus. Similarly, this thread could call hits plus plus and misses plus plus. Question is, how do you decide what locks to use? Well, one option is that you have only one lock. So let's say struct lock L, and wherever you have hits plus plus, you so let's say this code which says hits plus plus, before hits plus plus you're going to say acquire L, and after hits plus plus you're going to say release L. Right? Similarly, whenever you see misses plus plus, you could use the same lock. You could say acquire L and release L. Right? Is this correct? Well, it is correct because it will serialize all accesses to misses. It will also serialize all accesses to hits. But is it efficient? Well, it's not efficient because it's also serializing accesses to hits and misses. So if one thread is accessing hits and another thread is accessing misses, they will unnecessarily get serialized. They didn't need to get serialized because they are accessing different variables. Right? So this example is coarse grained locking. Unnecessarily, you're serializing. On that, what would have been a better way? You could have had two locks, one for hits. So let's say lock for hits, and another lock for misses. Right? And whenever you want to protect hits, you lock L underscore hits. Right? Whenever you want to, so similarly release L underscore hits. And whenever you want to protect misses, you're going to use L underscore misses. Right? This is finer. Fine-grained locking. Okay. So we have seen examples where you know, you could lock either using a coarse-grained or a fine-grained. Right. The coarse-grained locking basically allows that takes a global large locks, so the critical sections become larger, or the critical section becomes more because you're using the same lock to protect multiple things. Fine-grained locking has one lock per thing. So in the first example, I had one lock per list in fine-grained. In coarse-grained, I had one lock for all the lists. Right? Similarly, in the case of hits and misses, in the coarse-grained, I had one lock for both variables. In the fine-grained locking, I had one lock per variable. Okay? In general, fine-grained allows more concurrency. Okay, but fine-grained has its own problems. All right. So let's say what can happen. Let's see what can happen. Let's say one thread does hits plus plus, so let's say there are two locks, L hits and L misses. Right? And one thread calls acquire on L hits, then calls acquire on L misses, then says release, then does some computation, let's say hits is equal to hits plus misses or anything of that sort. Okay, and then it says release L hits, says release L misses. Okay, and let's say there's another thread which comes, and there's some other piece of code where it first acquires misses. It says acquire L misses, then says acquire L hits, perform some computation on hits and misses, and then says release L misses and release L hits. Okay. So in this case, I tried to use fine-grained locking, and I had one lock per variable, and I had two variables. But there's this piece of code which takes a lock on hits first, and then a lock on misses, and then does something. And this code takes a lock on misses first, then takes a lock on hits, and then does something, and then both of them release data. Right? Let's see what can happen. It is possible that one thread, the first thread calls acquire L underscore hits, it gets a lock, and this thread is somewhere here. Right? Then the second thread calls acquire L underscore misses, and let's say it acquires it, and it's somewhere here. Then this thread calls acquire L underscore misses. Will it get the lock? No, because this thread has already acquired the lock. So this thread starts waiting. Right? Then this thread tries to acquire L underscore hits. Will it get the lock? No. So this thread starts waiting. Okay. So is this correct? So will they ever stop waiting? Will they ever come out of the loop? Well, in this code, it seems like they will wait forever, right? Because this thread is waiting for lock misses, and it will not call release till it gets the lock, right? So release is somewhere here, and release will only be called after this lock is taken. But this lock will never be taken because the other thread is holding that lock. And it's also waiting. The other thread is also waiting. So both threads are waiting for the lock which is held by the other thread. Right? So what happens once again? T1 acquired L hits. T2 acquired L misses. Right, this is time downwards. So this is at time 1 this happened, at time 2 this happened, at time 3 T1 tries to acquire L hits but doesn't get it, right? Because L misses but doesn't get it because the other thread is already holding it, so waits. Right? In the time 4, T2 tries to acquire L hits and doesn't get it, waits. And in this case, they will end up waiting forever because the thread which has acquired L hits will never release it because it's waiting for thread 2 to release L misses. And so thread 1 is waiting for thread 2 to release something, thread 2 is waiting for thread 1 to release something, and they will just keep waiting for each other forever, right? So waits forever. Such a situation is called a deadlock. Okay. Let me go back to the code. Notice that this code looks correct. You know, if this code had executed in isolation, it would have done correct. It would have executed correctly. If this code had executed in isolation, it would have executed correctly. Right? Even if they were executing together, if this code executed before and this code executed after, everything would have been fine. The problem happens when these two codes interleave, right? When these two codes interleave, we get a deadlock, right? Like this. All right. Notice that deadlock happened because we were using fine-grained locking. Because we were using multiple locks, what happened was one thread acquired one lock and started waiting for another lock. The second, another thread acquired another lock, starting waiting for the first lock, and so you have a cycle in the wait loop, right? So basically what happened was thread 1 acquired L hits and was waiting for L misses. This is thread 1, and thread 2 has acquired L misses and is waiting for L hits, right? And that's the reason we have a deadlock. Okay. So if you were to draw, so a lock can be thought of as a resource, and if you were to draw a graph of all the resources, right, and draw edges between the resources, if a thread has acquired one resource and is waiting for another resource, so in this case thread 1 has acquired L hits and is waiting for L misses, so you draw an edge like this, right? And another thread could have acquired, so let's say this is L1, this is L2, L3, and let's say T1 has acquired L1 and is waiting for L2. So we can draw an edge from L1 to L2. Let's say T2 has acquired L2 and is waiting on L3. So you could draw an edge from L2 to L3. And let's say T3 has acquired L3 and is waiting on L1. This is also a deadlock, right? So one way to identify a deadlock is by basically drawing this this graph and representing locks as nodes and representing edges as threads which could potentially acquire one lock and wait for another lock. If you find a cycle in this graph, then there is a deadlock in your system, potential deadlock in your system. Okay. Notice that if I use coarse grain locking, then there is only one lock, and so there cannot be a cycle, right? So there will be only one node and no edges, and so no deadlock. All right. So deadlocks are a problem fine-grained locking. You have multiple locks, and you take one lock after another, and the order in which you take the locks basically causes a cycle in your graph. And that causes the entire system to just keep waiting for each other. Right? Okay. So question is, how does one solve this kind of a deadlock? Right. So let's, one way to solve this deadlock is to say that impose an order on the acquisition of locks. For example, you could say that whenever, so programmer could just follow this discipline in our previous code, whenever both L hits and L misses need to be acquired, always acquire L hits first. Let's say example, this is an example. Right? If you do that, then this code here, this code here will basically show, say that if you had to acquire both L hits and L misses, then you will first acquire L hits and then you will acquire L misses. So this is correct. Here you are doing it in the opposite order. So instead of doing this, you should have instead acquired L hits first, right? If you had done that, then I guarantee that there will be no deadlock, right? Why? Because you have said that locks will always be acquired in a certain order, right? If they will be acquired in a certain order, there will never be a cycle in your dependency graph, right? Notice that in this dependency graph, there was a thread which had acquired L hits and then was waiting for L misses. And there was another thread which had acquired L misses and was waiting for L hits. And so there was a cycle and we had a deadlock. On the other hand, if I say that L hits should always be acquired before L misses, then such an edge will not be possible. Right? You'll only have edges of this type. And so there will never be a cycle. Alright? And so there'll never be a circular weight dependency. And so there'll never be a deadlock. Okay? So this is common method of avoiding deadlocks in operating systems. The method is impose an order on the acquisition of locks. So you say that this lock will be acquired before that lock will be acquired. Okay? All right. At this point, I'll open the floor for questions before I move forward. Okay, there's a question from CE Pune. The question is a self deadlock possible with coarse grain locking? So question is self deadlock. Right, self deadlock means what? The same thread says acquire L and then it again calls acquire L. But this lock has already been acquired, so this will keep waiting forever. Okay. This is wrong code. Right. Yes, this is possible in coarse grain locking, but you know, the programmer should make sure that such a situation does not arise. Okay. All right. Any other questions? Okay, you can ask me questions if you have any while I'll go forward. So let's say, let's look at the case where, let's look at the first example that I had. Right. So here's the first example I had. Should we focus here? Right. So here's the first example I had, right? And here I had fine grain locking. Okay, and here I had fine grain locking and I had a lock per list. Right? So I acquired L dot lock and then released L dot lock. So what can happen in this, so this is fine grain locking and let's see how a lock could happen here. So let's say I had code which said insert okay, so hold on, so let's say this is basically a fine grain locking where you have a lock per list, right? In this case the entity that you are having is only one. Let's take another example, right? So let's say I'm a bank right? And I have accounts. So I have, you know, struct account. And I have accounts of multiple people. So let's say I have an account for, you know, A, and I have another account for B, C, and so on, right? Or let's say I have an array of us, right? Then I'm running a function called transfer money. So let's say there's a function called transfer, which takes two accounts. So struct account star A, struct account star B, and that's it. Right? So let's say this array is some accounts. What this transfer function does is it transfers 1 rupee from account A to account B, right? So it just says A dot money minus minus and B dot money plus plus. Okay. All right. But it also needs to make sure that A's account has some money, right? Money cannot become negative. So money has to remain positive. So you can only deduct a rupee from A's account if, you know, A dot money is than zero. You say A dot money is greater than zero. Then, only then, transfer the money. Otherwise, don't transfer the money. Okay. Let's say this is my function. Okay. Now, these accounts are global variables. They are global, globally declared, right? And I could pass any of these as arguments to this function. This function looks correct if only one thread was executing, right? But if there are multiple threads executing, what can go wrong? Well, what can go wrong is two threads can come in. Let's say the account A had only 1 rupee in the beginning. So both threads are going to check if money is greater than zero. They're both going to read that, oh, a dot money is equal to 1, so it's greater than 0, that's fine. And then both of them are going to decrement a dot money, so it's going to become minus 1, right? So let's say one thread calls transfer from A to B, account A to account B, and the other thread says transfer account A to account C, and let's say initially A dot money is equal to 1, right? So what should happen is that this should execute after this. So these functions should execute atomically, right? If they don't execute atomically, then what can happen is bad things can happen. You know, somebody's account can have minus 1 in his account. That doesn't make sense. Also, it's possible that if they interleave in a bad way, then some money can be lost, right? Because what can happen is while you are decrementing, there can be a race condition and the update can be lost, right? Just like when we were trying to increment hits. In this case, you are trying to increment money. And so recall that one of the increments was lost in hits. So similarly, one of the increments in money can get lost. Right. So what do you need? You need atomicity of this transfer function. Right. So what am I going to do? I'm going to use locks to enforce atomicity. Right. How am I going to? Locks. So this is basically say struct lock g lock, so I have global lock, right? And then I could do what? I could put acquire g lock here, and I could say release G lock here, right? So that makes it correct, right? Because this whole data, this whole code becomes the critical section and gets serialized. Okay, so this becomes correct. However, if one thread was calling transfer A to B and another thread is calling transfer C to D, they will get serialized. Because of G lock, right? But notice that this is, these are two different accounts A and B, and these are two different accounts C and D. They didn't need to get serialized, right? Right? So this is unnecessarily serialized. What would have been a better way? Right? What would have been a better way? Instead of having a global lock, have a lock per account, right? So let's say account A has a lock and account B has a lock, and because I'm operating on A and B, I could acquire locks on both of them. Right. So I could say acquire A dot lock and release A dot lock. Right. But I'm operating on two accounts, so I need to take two locks, right? Because I need to make ensure that mutual exclusion is on both A and B. Right. So let's rewrite this on a different sheet. It's getting too crowded here. So one way to do this could have been to say void transfer account A, account B, here I have code which says if A dot money is greater than 0, A dot money minus minus, B dot money plus plus, right? And I could say, oh, but before I do all this, I should acquire a lock, and in this case I will acquire A dot lock, and then I'll acquire B dot lock. Okay. Similarly, I will release A dot lock and release B dot lock. Notice that I need A dot lock because I'm reading and writing account A. I need to acquire B dot lock because I'm also reading and writing account B. Right? So I need to take both locks. I cannot just take one lock. I need to take both before I execute this code. Right? Now if I do this, this code is correct. Right? But it has a problem of deadlock, right? So what can happen? One thread can call transfer money from A to B, and another thread could call transfer from B to A, right? And what can happen is the first thread first argument becomes capital A, so it will acquire capital A's lock, and the second thread will acquire capital B's lock, and now both of them are going to wait for the lock held by the other thread, and you're going to have a lock, deadlock, right? So if one thread executes transfer AB, another thread executes transfer BA, you have a potential deadlock. Okay. In fact, let's take another scenario. Let's say one thread calls transfer AB, another thread calls transfer BC, and yet another thread calls transfer CA. You still have a deadlock, potential deadlock, right? Because thread A could have taken lock A and waiting for lock B. Thread B 2 could have taken lock B waiting for lock C, and thread 3 could have taken lock C waiting for lock A, and you have a cycle and you have a potential deadlock. So how do you solve this problem? Right? So once again, I said we're going to impose an order in which locks are taken. Right? So in this case, the order, there is no order really, because depending on who was the first argument of this function, the lock order gets decided, right? Okay. So what could fix it? Well, one way to fix this is I basically decide which lock to take first. All right. So one way to fix this is, let me write it on another sheet. I'm going to say, when I'm going to acquire these locks, I'm going to say if, let's say I sort the accounts on the basis of the account number. So if A dot number is less than B dot number, then acquire A dot lock, and then acquire B dot lock, else B dot number is less than A dot number, in which case you acquire B dot lock first. Okay, so ordering of lock acquisition. All right, now you will do all the other things. For example, if A dot money is greater than zero, then do whatever you want to do. And then you're going to say release A dot lock and release B dot lock. Let me write it here. Now this code becomes correct, right? Do the release need to be ordered? No, release don't need to be ordered because release don't wait, right? It's only the acquire that waits. So now let's see what happens if there are two threads which call transfer A, B, and another thread calls transfer B, A. Now, this will acquire, let's say, if A was less than B, A's account number was less than B's account number, then it will first acquire A and then acquire B. Even in this case, if A's account number is less than B's account number, it will first acquire A and then acquire B. Alright? So in this case, there will be no deadlock. Because because, okay. Similarly, in this example, once again, you don't have a deadlock anymore, right? Because let's say A is less than B is less than C, then A will be acquired before B. Here, B will be acquired before C, but here, A will be acquired before C, right? So you will not have a cycle. You will not have a cycle in your dependency graph. Okay. All right. So I'm going to stop here and open the floor for questions. Questions? Okay, there are no questions. Let's stop and meet next week on Monday.